Professor Tolkien, The Lord of the Rings is one of the most remarkable works of fiction of this century. And I'm going to start with one or two questions about possible source material. For example, I thought that conceivably Midgard might be Middle Earth or have some connection.
Oh, yes, they're the same word. Most people have made this mistake, thinking Middle Earth is a particular kind of Earth or is another planet, and you know, in the science fiction sort. But it's simply an old-fashioned word for this world we live in, as imagined, surrounded by the ocean.
It seemed to me that Middle Earth was in a sense, as you say, this world we live in. But this world we live in at a different era.
Well, no, at a different stage of imagination. Yeah.
But this is interesting because in The Lord of the Rings, particularly in the appendices, you go to great trouble to get your chronology exactly correct with respect to the four ages that you write about, but you make no attempt at all to tie this up with time as we know it today. Why is this?
Because it would have been impossible. Because it would have completely interfered with and trampled one in a free invention of history and an incident to one's story.
Nevertheless, despite what you've just said, it seems to me that one could place most of the action, if not all of the action, within a fairly definite sort of time.
It won't really work out, you know, either paleontologically or archaeologically at all, actually. I mean, you can't really relate the land masses, I described them, satisfactorily to the land masses we know now. Nor, of course, can you really have such a sort of mixed culture as I describe, which includes tobacco umbrellas and other things, to what little is known of archaeological history. I wanted people simply to get inside this story and take it, in a sense, of actual history. It seemed to me that to be cut off by a vague abyss of ages had exactly the same effect as you get in a scientific story when you go to some remote part of the galaxy. They don't really explain how, but you get the sense of being far away, that's all. In a possible world, but far away. This is the same sort of thing in time, isn't it?
Oh, yes, but in what one might call science fiction, the authors seldom go to the trouble, anything like the trouble you've done, in tying this imagined world so closely to the world as we know it. Because so much of this is very close to what we know, I won't say today, but in the recent historical past.
Oh, yes, it resembles some of the history of Greece and Rome as against the perpetual infiltration of people out of the East, doesn't it?
Yes.
Yes, it certainly does that. But then, of course, a poor man building a story has to build it out of some of the things he himself knows. He doesn't rush around to Roman history and go and see where that happened to it. But, I mean, if he's been brought up, as I was, on ordinary history and on his reading, that will be the material out of which he constructs.
I've been interested in the fact that many of the names of which you have created thousands in the book, I mean, literally thousands, are very close to Norse legend names. For example, Gimli is the name of the Hall of Gold.
That's another point, yeah. This particular lot of dwarves, as I call them, came from the extreme north of my geography. And therefore, in translating, as I explained in the section on translation, the kind of language they came up against there would be of a northern kind. The dwarves, you remember, are represented as extremely secretive people and have private names in their own secret language, and public names like gypsies. Therefore, I gave the North actual Norse names, which are in Norse books. That's quite different. Not that my dwarves really are at all like the dwarves of Norse imagination, but there's a whole list of rather attractive dwarf names in one of the older Eddaic poems. I'm afraid I simply begged them.
But not only in the dwarves, though, but among the descendants of the elves, the race of Numenor, it seems to me that one or two of the names relate to other things. You speak of the two trees of Valinor, Laurelin and the Telperion, if my pronunciation is anything like
Laurelin, that. Laurelin and Telperion, yes, the golden song and the white silver.
Are these in any way reflections in your world of the great world tree, the Norse world tree?
No, they're not like it. They're much more like the trees of the sun and the moon, discovered in the Far East in the great Alexander stories.
Trees play a very important part throughout the Lord of the Rings. For example, the Malorn trees in Lothlorien and the white tree of the Citadel of Minas Tirith.
Oh, yes, they're all descendants, yes.
These are trees that are more than trees because they are symbols. Of great importance. Is there something in your own life, in your own background,
They're not symbols to me at all. I don't work in symbols at all. Other people can find that they are symbolic. They may be symbols in my mind, but they're not symbols to me in my conscious mind at all. I'm entirely historically minded.
Well, this is true, perhaps, but nevertheless, you use the white tree of Minas Tirith as a symbol of lordship, of kingship, do you not?
Oh, well, yes, yes, an emblem, certainly, yes, yes, yes.
But not symbolic of anything more than...
Well, what are the leopards of England symbolic of?
I take your point. Now, the rangers, they protect men and hobbits from Sauron's servants, but particularly they seem to have a fondness for the Shire. Have you a particular fondness for these comfortable, homely things of life that the Shire embodies? The, you know, home and pipe and fire and bed, the homely virtues.
Haven't you?
Haven't you, Professor
Tolkien?
Of course,
yes, 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 yes.
You have a particular fondness, then,
yes,
for hobbits.
That's where I feel at home. The Shire is very like the kind of world in which I first became aware of things. Very like. Which was perhaps more poignant to me because I wasn't born in it. I was born in Bloemfontein, South Africa. I was very young when I got back, but at the same time, it bites into your memory and imagination, even if you don't think it has. If your first Christmas tree is a wilting eucalyptus, and if you're normally troubled by heat and sand, then to have, just at the age of imagination is opening out, suddenly find yourself in a quiet Warwickshire village. I think it engenders a particular love of what you might call central Midland English countryside, based on good water stones and elm trees and small quiet rivers and so on. And, of course, sort of rustic people about.
At what age did you come to England?
I was, I suppose, when I was landing, about 3 and a half. Pretty poignant, of course, because you see, one of the things why people say they don't remember is because it's like constantly photographing the same thing on the same plate. Slight changes simply make a blur. But if a child's had a sudden break like that, it's conscious. What it tries to do is to fit the new memories onto the old. I've got a perfectly clear, vivid picture of a house, but I now know that it's a beautifully worked out pastiche of my own home in Bloemfontein and my grandmother's house in Birmingham. Because I can still remember going down the road in Birmingham wondering what had happened to the gallery, what had happened to the balcony. So constantly I do remember things extremely early. I can remember bathing in the Indian Ocean when I was not quite 2, and I remember it very clearly.
I'm going to return again also this business of memory and looking back a great distance. Let me turn to another subject for a moment. Frodo accepts the burden of the ring. Yeah. And he embodies, as a character, the virtues of long-suffering and perseverance. And by his actions, one might almost say, in the Buddhist sense, he acquires merit. He becomes, in fact, almost a Christ figure. Why did you choose a halfling, a hobbit, for this role?
Well, I didn't. I didn't do much choosing. I wrote The Hobbit, which all I was trying to do in the role was just to carry on from the point where the hobbit left off. Well, there I got hobbits on my hand, didn't I?
Indeed, but there's nothing particularly Christ-like about Bilbo.
Oh, no. No, no.
It seemed to me strange that this small hobbit from a small...
I shouldn't say that he was Christ-like. I think as a personage, but of course he has some of the features of Christ. I guess accepting of a
perhaps
burden,
I've exaggerated.
A burden, accepting a burden, but because you...
But in the face of the most appalling danger, he struggles on and continues and wins through.
But that seems... Well, I thought it was more like an allegory of the human race. I've always been impressed. We are here surviving because of the indomitable courage of quite small people against impossible odds. Jungles, volcanoes, wild beasts. They struggle on, almost blindly in a way. Frodo had very little idea, really. Because he, by the time he came to the end of his quest, he was beginning to understand things very much more. I thought the wisest remark in the whole book was that where Elrond says that the wheels of the world are turned with the small hands while the great are looking elsewhere, and they turn because they have to, because it's the daily job.
Did you intend in The Lord of the Rings that certain races should embody certain principles, the elves' wisdom, the dwarfs' craftsmanship, men, husbandry and battle and so forth?
Didn't intend it, but when you've got these people on your hands, you've got to make them different, haven't you? Well, of course, as we all know, ultimately, we've only got humanity to work with. It's the only clay we've got. And, of course, any races you make, if they're speaking and thinking, are taken from certain parts of humanity as one knows it, with slight alterations of emphasis. That's all you can do, isn't it, really, ultimately? Because the elves are simply, in its sense, an expression certain, not really wholly legitimate desires the human race has about itself. We should all, or at least a large part of the human race, would like to have greater power of mind, greater power of art, by which I mean that the gap between the conception and the power of execution should be shortened. We should like that, and we should like, of course, longer time, if not indefinite time, which to go on knowing more and making more. Well, therefore, we make the elves immortal in a sense. I had to use immortal, but I didn't mean that they were eternally immortal, merely that they are very longeval, and their longevity probably lasts as long as the inhabitability of the earth. The dwarves, of course, quite obviously, couldn't you say in many ways they remind you of the Jews? All their words are Semitic, obviously, and constructed be Semitic. There's a tremendous love of the artifact, and of course the immense warlike capacity of the Jews too, which we tend to forget nowadays. Our hobbits are just, well, rustic English people, made small in size because it reflects the general small reach of their imagination, but it's not the small reach of their courage or latent power.
You're obviously intensely interested in age for its own sake. I mean, Fanghorn, for example, and the Ents are the eldest. They have been in existence longer. Tom Bombadil is described, in fact, is he not, as the eldest.
Well, he's, of course, a very odd character, but we won't interfere with you now. You're asking about age.
Age as such. You're very in antiquity. You're greatly interested in long life, in longevity. The Eldar's descendants all have this gift of longer life. Could you expand on that?
Well, that's different. Longer life, that's purely, that's what's... That's oneself. That's because it's an added power in this world. Also, if you are intelligent and artistic person, it gives you more time, both either to perfect your work or else to do more. That's rather different to the appeal of antiquity itself. I love history, and I always feel you. Even when you walk into a room, you really feel you ought to know the history, but not only the room but the people. We walk in with all this tremendous history behind us. But if you're writing a story which you know you're going to come to the end of that history. The history's always backwards, isn't it?
Did you evolve a system for naming these races, and therefore their histories and alphabets, literature and so on?
I didn't evolve it, I merely used what I knew. But that is a rather different question, really. But every human being, at least every human being who is gifted at all in that way, has what you might call his own native language. That's quite distinct from the first learnt. What we call a native language, your first learnt. But every human being has an individual linguistic character, as he has an individual face, colouring and body. And I think, therefore, you find that people have what I should call linguistic predilections. But, of course, like one's physical characteristics, that shifts a bit as you grow, and also as you have more experience. Well, the language I've entered tried to fit my actual personal linguistic predilection or pleasure. Well, now, obviously, from history, those two languages have got to be related. They're quite different. All you do is you have to posit a purely invented original form or original sound scheme. And then you have to make language A develop certain sound laws and come to B, and certain other ones produce B. They will then be related, however little related they seem, but it will have that sort of feeling.
So, therefore, if you have, for the purposes of the plot or purposes of some part of the book, to invent a new name for a new character, if you consciously say to yourself, in Quenyard his name will be so-and-so, but in Sindarin his name will be this.
Yes, you do have that. In the first test, it has to sound a nice name to me, even if I don't know what it means. But then you, of course, come across this unfortunate fact that it doesn't always happen that if you... Then work that those same elements with the same meaning into a name, and it doesn't always come out as a nice name, in spite of that. So then you have to give them another name or do something about it. Yes, it's a minor technical craft, actually.
Well, it's an interesting technical craft because you do it with equal success when you name unpleasant characters like orcs, because all your unpleasant characters are instantly identifiable as unpleasant characters the minute one reads their names.
Yes, I suppose they would. You wouldn't like thinking much of a chap called Ugloo, could you? No.
Yet dwarves, although they have names composed of similarly uncomfortable consonants to the English ear, the names are not unattractive.
No.
Immediately they're attractive. Yes. And this seems to me one of the great strengths of the book, amid this enormous conglomeration of names. One doesn't get lost. After the first reading, after the second reading of the book.
Well, it does need an extra. I'm very glad you told me, because I gave a great deal of trouble. Well, you must, you see. My things, I did try to use the languages which I did understand, which is, after all, the primary and most important of all cultural appendages. I tried to use them for that purpose, to guide right. Also, of course, gives me great pleasure. A good name. I always, in the writing, always start with a name. Give me a name and it produces a story, not the other way about, normally.
Of the languages you know, which were the greatest help to you in writing The Lord of the Rings?
Oh, no. Yes. Well, of course, I started trying to invent languages almost at once, because same way that my reading of myth has been disturbed, because I've never hardly got through any fairy story without wanting to write one myself.
It's perhaps an added discipline to trace back anyway to sources in a work of this sort. But do you trace in the languages you invented more to Scandinavia or more or later things like Middle English? Or
I don't know. No, of these sort of modern languages, I should have said that Welsh was always attracted me by its style and sound more than any other. Even though I first only saw it on coal trucks, I always wanted to know what it was about.
It seems to me, certainly, that the music of Welsh comes through in the names you've chosen for mountains and for places in general.
Yeah.
Do you acknowledge this?
Yes, very much. But a much rarer, but very potent influence on myself has been Finnish.
Now, women play very little part indeed in The Lord of the Rings. Eowyn is almost the only woman in the book who shows any sign of sexual awareness at all. Did you deliberately exclude sex from the book?
No, but after all, these are wars and a terrible expedition to the North Pole, so to speak.
But other writers have occasionally allowed their characters to digress, if it be digression in this way.
Surely there's no lack of interest, is it?
It's not a case of lack of interest at all.
Wouldn't you have thought that Galadriel... Every character is tempted at some point. Wouldn't you have thought Galadriel's temptation and what she says about herself is significant?
Yes, I think so. But there is always... at one remove.
I don't know how to explain it. I know that how one reviewer explained it. He says it's written by a man who's never reached puberty and knows nothing about women except for a schoolboy. And all his characters, all the good characters come home like happy boys, safe from the war. I thought it was very rude from a man, as far as I know, he's childless, to writing about a man surrounded with children, wife, daughter, grandchildren. Still, it isn't that. That's not the reason. And of course, it's equally untrue, isn't it, that it's a happy story. One friend of mine said he only read it in Lent because it was so hard and bitter.
To turn to a practical point. How did The Lord of the Rings develop from The Hobbit? Because clearly it developed.
Oh, yes. If, of course, The Hobbit was successful. Naturally, I was pressed for a sequel. I looked for the only point in it that showed signs of development. So I thought we'd choose the ring as the key to the next story. That's the mere germ, of course. Yeah. Then when I saw, of course, that if you're going to make I wanted to make a big story, I felt got to be the ring. No, it's not a magic ring. I invented that little rhyme. I remember my bath one day.
Now, this germ actually, of course, is also present, isn't it, in many mythologies? I mean, in Scandinavian mythology, there are rings of power, are there not?
Yes, there are.
It's
yes,
guarded by dragons, is it not, in Germanic legend? I suppose Smaug might be interpreted as being a sort of Fafnir, is he?
Oh, yes, very much so. Except no, Fafnir was a human being, you see, or a being, a humanoid, shall we say, being who took this form, whereas Smaug is just, he's pure intelligent lizard.
You have a fondness for intelligent lizards?
Well, dragons always attracted me as a mythological element. Yeah. They seem to be able to comprise human malice and bestiality together so extraordinarily well, and a sort of malicious wisdom and shrewdness. A terrifying creature.
Asking how The Lord of the Rings began leads on to this question.
Then grew without control.
Without control, this is the point. You did not have a scheme. No outline at all.
Well, except that was a major one, that the ring had got to be...
I mean, did you know the ring had to be destroyed from the beginning?
Yes, that. You see, because Janos says so quite early. Therefore, at some point, a hobbit has got to make his way to the cracks of doom, obviously, isn't it? That's the only thing. And several times I tried to write that last scene ahead of time. It didn't come out. It never worked. Oh, I had to wait for it to come through.
Did you decide right at the beginning that Gollum was to play such a part, or did you go back through the book after and write in the various linking parts of Gollum?
You couldn't get Gollum out, could you, if you think of Gollum's relation to the ring? If the ring is going to be important, then the Gollum business must have been important. I liked him better than all the other characters, and much more sorry for him.
But, you see, this is interesting because he's practically the only grey character, with the possible exception of Boromir, right through the book.
And Denethor, yes.
The others are almost completely black and white.
They all have their temptations, actually. Yes.
They all have their temptations, but nevertheless, the moment you've established your character, your reader knows what his own personal character is. Going to be a goodie or a baddie.
Yes, yes. Well, of course, yes. One knows that isn't generally true, but I have to simplify a little. Yes.
But that's why Gollum is so interesting, because one, you know, he almost repents at one point, doesn't he, where he sees Frodo.
That is the most poignant moment of all. Because it's so terribly true. It's the good people who do the damage so often. It was Sam's suspicious faithfulness was very much justified, which ruined Gollum. You see, that if you go a long, long way in wickedness, then comes your chance, but you can't therefore demand that it should be made nice and easy at that point. It's going to be probably very sticky, the last chance, and it was too sticky for Gollum, because I spent a lot of thought about it, because he grew on me. I mean, I almost could see Gollum. Where I've been most criticised by certain people, and where I think I'm the most right, is making point of fact, though I do praise them for seeing it, is a photo actually failed. The thing that some people have said about it is extraordinary. You would have thought in this age, when we are now faced with with the absolute certainty of pressures which can't be resisted, people would realize more clearly than ever did before that the motives which will go into such a situation are so important. It's very rash to put yourself in a position you know to be too powerful for you. That's presumption. If you go in with good motives and then land in a position which you can't face up to, then that's up to the government, isn't it? Some people have been very angry about it. Sort of people that deprive a man of his scissors when he came back after being brainwashed and a ratchet or given something away, I suppose. That's a sign of mind. There is still a bunch of such.
It's true, yes. But you find that your correspondents, in fact, complain a great deal about certain incidents in the story, or have complained.
I once said, and I think it's roughly true, that if I should listen to my correspondents, every part of the Lord of the Rings is a failure or it's only weakness. On the other hand, there's another list which every part of it is particular strength.
At what point, I'd like to know, if you can judge at all, did the book take control of you?
Long before I wrote The Hobbit and long before I wrote this, they had constructed this world mythology. It was already in existence. It was offered to the publisher before the...
I know.
This mythology and the Eldar and the Valar and the Western Paradise and the Elves and the Dwarves and so on, they don't arise the first time in this book. They'd already been constructed. There's nothing in the appendices referred to that hasn't already been written.
So you had some sort of scheme on which it was possible to work?
Well, an immense saga, yes. Well, it rather seems that they got sucked into it, as The Hobbit did itself. You see, The Hobbit was originally not part of it at all, but as soon as it got moving out into the world, it got sucked into it.
So your characters and your story really took charge? I say took charge, I don't mean that you were completely under their spell or anything of this sort.
Oh, no, I don't walk about dreaming at all, no. No, it doesn't, an obsession anyway. Other people have had written large things, they have the same sensation that you have sometimes. It may be a purely psychological delusion, but you have a sensation that, but at this point, A, B, C, D, only A, one of them is right, and you've got to wait till you see. Well, of course, that's no doubt subconscious goes on working on these things. Anyway, it's no good trying to anticipate, because all the things I've tried to write ahead at times just to direct myself all proved to be no good when you got there. A story like it has to be written backwards as well as forwards.
This is, I thought, probable, yes.
Well, you see, Boromir. Well, he had to be put back. Boromir came important at a certain point, but of course, he had to be put right back into book one. Of course, I had maps, of course. If you're going to have a complicated story, you must work to a map, otherwise you can never make a map of it afterward. The moons, I think, finally, the moons and suns have worked out according to what they were in this part of the world in 1942, actually. They must have something where they I mean, I'm not a good enough mathematician or astronomer to work out whether they might have been 7,000, 8,000 years ago, but as long as they correspond to some real configuration of what was good enough. Moons are much more tricky to deal with than suns, of course. But on the whole, I don't think a moon is full or rising in the wrong place.
You began in 42, did you, to write it?
Oh, no, I began in 30, as soon as the Hobbit was out, in the 30s, you know.
And when did you... It was finally finished just before it was published,
in 54? I about 1949, I think. I remember blotting... I remember the I actually wept at the Field of Cormallin, where, of course, the tears come easier, I think, with... At the good denouement, I think. But then, of course, it was a tremendous lot of revision. I typed the whole of that work out twice, and lots of it many times, on a bed in an attic, because they couldn't afford the, of course, the typing. There were some mistakes too. And also, what I amuses me to say, because I suppose I'm in a position which it doesn't matter what people think of me now, some frightful mistakes in grammar from a professor of English language, literally rather shocking. You know.
I haven't noticed any.
Well, there's one where I use bestrode as the past passive of bestride. Well, there's a lot of things like that, yeah.
Will you ever correct them in another edition, or...
I have sent you some corrections, but there always seem to be new ones cropping up. Yes, there are some. And, of course, dwarves are really mistaken grammar, of course. I've tried to cover it up, but it's just purely the fact that... I have a tendency to increase the number of these vestigial approvals, which is a change of consonant, like leaves. My tendency is to make more of them than are now standard. And I really thought dwarves, why not?
Did you evolve the languages before you wrote the book?
Oh, yes. Yes. Well, yes, I've altered them a little. I mean, indeed, long before. In fact, they began before the mythology.
For what purpose? Just for fun?
Expressing one's own tastes. After all, isn't that what artists do?
Of course, but you see, an artist paints a picture, presumably for himself, but occasionally with communication in mind. Had you invented these languages with any sense of communication with other people?
No, but I hope to find one. I found it in the book. Yes. Of course, it's not uncommon, you know. It's mostly done by boys. It's frowned on because they get a guilt complex about it, because it's taking off their time from something else. An enormously greater number of children have what you might call a creative element in them than is usually supposed. And it isn't necessarily limited to certain things. They may not want to paint or draw, they may not have much music, but they nonetheless want to create something. And if the main mass of education takes linguistic form, it'll take, their creation will take linguistic form, even if it isn't one of their talents, won't it? It's so extraordinarily common. I once did think that it's an awful pity that there ought to be some organised research in it, I think. Be very fascinating, not only from the point of view of art education and impact of education on that part, which would be fascinating from that point of view, but it's extraordinarily interesting in getting a large body of records of the linguistic predilections of children at certain ages.
Do you feel any sense of guilt at all that as a philologist, as a professor of English language, with which you were concerned with the factual sources of language, you devoted a large part of your life to a fictional thing?
No, I've surely done language a lot of good. No, there's quite a lot of linguistic wisdom in it. I don't feel any guilt complex about the Lord of the Rings, as many people have said. Now we know what you've wasted the last 14 years upon, you can now get on and complete some of those professional tasks which you neglected. And so, immediately after I retired, I was more busy working at my proper things than I'd been for a long while. Yes.
Is the book to be considered as an allegory?
No. I just like allegory whenever I smell it.
Do you consider the world declining as the third age declines in your book? And do you see a fourth age for the world at the moment? Our world?
Well, the person of my age, you see, is exactly the kind of person who's lived through one of the most quickly changing periods of known to history. And that the world is a totally different place now, at a speed. Everybody feels that. Anybody who lives over 70 begins to feel that all through history. You can see that they do. But surely never been in 70 years so much change.
Oh, surely never, no. This, I mean, one doesn't have to be 70 years old to appreciate this.
The world, which I brought up as a small child, was indefinitely closer to the world, say, of Shakespeare.
There's an autumnal quality throughout the whole of The Lord of the Rings. There's a sense of continuous change. Each character feels himself to be part of a story that's forever continuing. You, in one case, a character says the story is continuing, but I seem to have dropped out of it.
Yes.
However, everything's declining and it's fading, at least towards the end of the Third Age. Every choice tends to the upsetting of some tradition. Now, this seems to me to be somewhat like Tennyson's "The old order changeth, yielding place to new, and God fulfills himself in many ways." Where is God in The Lord of the Rings?
He mentioned once or twice.
Is he the one above the Elder?
The one, yeah, the one, yeah.
Despite the continuous war between evil, personified in Sauron, and good, you never personalize or personify goodness. Good is there, but it's totally abstract. You don't attempt to ascribe any godship to it, particularly.
No. It isn't the dualistic mythology it's based on. No, certainly not.
But, I mean, the whole book is nevertheless nothing but the battle between good and evil.
Well, that's, I suppose, actual conscious reaction from the war, from the stuff that I was brought up in a war to end wars, which I didn't believe in at the time, and believe in less now.
If I can take this a bit further, I may make my point clearer. In battle, Frodo and Sam call on Galadriel, or their native country. Gimli calls on his ancestor's axe, if I read your appendices correctly, and the men call only on their swords by name, or on their kings or lords. I would expect them to call on their gods, and yet amid thousands of names, you don't name the deities of any of the races you've invented. Why? Have they no gods as such?
There aren't any.
I would have thought a story of this sort was almost dependent upon an intense belief in some theocratic division, some hierarchy.
There is indeed, but that's where the theocratic hierarchy comes in. The man of the 20th century must, of course, see that you must have, whether he believes them or not, you must have gods in a story of this kind. But he can't make himself believe in gods like Thor and Odin, Aphrodite, Zeus and that kind of thing.
You can't believe that the men in your story would have called on Odin.
I couldn't possibly construct a mythology which had Olympus or Asgard in it. On the terms in which the people who worship those gods believed in. God is supreme, the creator, outside, transcendent. But the place of the gods is taken, so well taken, I think, that it really makes no difference to the ordinary reader, is taken by the angelic spirits created by God, but created before the particular time sequence which we call the world, which is called in their language Ea, that which is, that which now exists. Those are the valor, the power. It's a construction, which is a mythology in which a large part of the demiurgic thing has been handed over to powers which are created therein under the one. It's something like, but much more elaborate and more thought out than C.S. Lewis's business when he's out of the silent planet, where you have a demiurgos who's acting command of the planet Mars. And the idea there was that Lucifer was originally the one in command of the world, but he fell. So it was the silent planet, it had fallen out of that, was the idea. Well, this is not the same with me.
Yes, yes. So then you have, in your theocracy, you have an ultimate one,
yes,
whom you call...
It's called the One Only.
The One Only. And then the Valar,
yeah,
who are considered as living in Valinor.
This particular little group of them who moved from other parts of the universe to this part because they became interested in it.
In the book, I get the impression you always see power as being physically in a high place. You have a high seat. There's Orthanc, Medusel, Barad-dûr, the towers of Minas Tirith, Morgul and Cirith Ungol. They are always high, physically up. Is power for you always, so to speak, at the top of a mountain or top of a...
Well, that's just a symbol, isn't it? Oh, no, as a matter of fact, it's just a story to anything. You want towers and so on that could have them down in a dungeon or underneath. There are, as a matter of fact, Morgoth, the prime mover of evil, of whom Sauron was only a petty lieutenant, lives in a dungeon. He must be in a fortress or of some kind. Not that Valinor has any high towers, just a...
Well, that is almost without the world you describe, isn't it?
It's in the physical world, according to the myth.
Ah.
Until the downfall of Atlantis. I have an Atlantis complex in addition to all these other things. And quite independent of that, I have a permanent dream that I had, you know. Let's say that the ineluctable wave has been one of my nightmares, sometimes coming in over the open country. It always ends by one surrendering oneself. And one wakes up. It comes in all kinds of points. Like whenever I used to doodle and draw, it's nearly always a lone figure with the vast oceanic wave coming in. So, of course, I had to write quite independently these Atlantis stories, which I call Numenor, which means the land of the extreme western earth. Well, this is the fable, you see. Since the whole question of the human fall is left off the stage, actually. It occurred, but they're not known. Since the regrace, these people, they were given this great island, the first all west, not in the divine world, not in the immortal world, to live on. Then, of course, will always come a seemingly meaningless ban, like the fruit of the tree of evil. Lewis used the same thing in his Perelandra. Their ban was they mustn't sail west. They did.
Hence the ultimate downfall.
It then became an intellectual. It lived then only in memory. It lived in time, but not present time. And, of course, Numenor was drowned, and the earthly paradise was removed. And so then you could then get South America. Told you that the world became round. It always had been a vast globe, but people can now sail around, discovered it round. That's where it was my solution of the thing. I also wanted to give the fall of Atlantis some universal application. The point is, really, I've written some story about it, which, as they get to that, you suddenly see the real curvature of the world going down like a bridge. You're on a line which leads to what was. Of course, I don't know what your theory of time is, but what was, what is, if it ever had an existence, must still has that same existence. But you can't go too deep into those things, but they really are sailing back to a world of memory.
In this world which you might have created, had you been given the power to do so, had you been one of the Valar, had you been, save the mark, God, would you have created a world which is so solidly feudal as the Lord of the Rings?
Oh, yes, very much so, yes. I think the feudal... I mean, you mean feudal...
In the widest sense.
In the French sense, not in the strict way.
Oh, no, in the widest sense.
Hierarchical, rather, yes.
Hierarchical, exactly, yes.
Yes, yes, I think so.
I mean, that power should descend by a line of kings to their sons. This sort
hereditary,
of thing.
Yes. I don't know about that. No, it's a very potent story-making and emotive thing, but how far would say does really work better than any other system in looking at the history of the world? One doubts pretty much. It's never been worse, at any rate, than the struggle for power that always ensues when you haven't got some line of descent which can't be questioned.
You're wedded to the feudal system, in a sense. Not, I don't mean the medieval feudal system, but the idea of power descending through blood or through marriage. Or...
Yes, I'm rather wedded to those kind of loyalties because I think, contrary to most people, I think that touching your cap to the squire may be damn bad for the squire, but it's damn good for you.
Do you find a continuing interest in The Lord of the Rings by people? Do people still write to you, or despite the fact that the book's been out for 10 years?
Dozens of letters a week, yeah. Or have to keep a secret to answer them, yeah.
Were you surprised at its success?
Nobody been more staggered, you know. Unless it was possibly Sir Stanley Irwin. I was up at Stanley Irwin's birthday celebration, and a bookseller came up to me. I don't usually greet you with such fervor, but he said that while he got copies, it sold so well it practically kept him going for a while. Well, he gets his guinea off the set, you see.
Almost the last question. Do you, in fact, believe yourself, not in the context of this book, but believe in the sense of straightforward, strict belief, in the Eldar or in some form of governing
spirit? Well, the Eldar mustn't be distinguished from the Eldar only.
The Valar, I mean, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Are you, in fact, a theist?
Oh, I'm a Roman Catholic. Devout Roman Catholic, yes, but I don't know about angelology. Yes, I should have thought almost certainly. Certainly.
Well, they seem to me to be the saints, or the equivalent of the saints.
Well, they are in some ways, yes. Yeah. They take the place in this book of the things which in many evil and older legends you have the gods and the invocation of the saints, which are lesser angels. Yes, they do. Oh, well, obviously many people have noticed that the appealing to the Lady, the Queen of the Stars, which is almost like Roman Catholic of invocations of Our Lady.
Do you wish to be remembered chiefly by your writings on philology, on other matters, or by The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit?
I shouldn't have thought there's not much choice in it. If I remember at all, it'd be by The Lord of the Rings, I'd take it. I wouldn't mind the other being remembered, but I am conscious of the small and not very important. Won't it be rather like the case of Longfellow, won't it? People remember Longfellow wrote Hiawatha and perhaps one or two other things. They quite forget he was a professor of modern languages.